Today we are going to study about the character of God. And this is one of my favorite studies, and it's a fun study to do for me. Last week we learned some important things about the Ten Commandments, and because a lot of people teach that the law is done away with or changed, but we saw plainly from the Word of God that there is no difference between the Old Testament and the New Testament when it comes to God's Ten Commandment law. We saw very clearly that the New Testament teaches us to keep the Ten Commandments just as much as the Old Testament does. And so with this in mind, let us consider this great subject about the character of God. What do we mean when we say the character of God? Well, if you just look it up in the dictionary, the word character, and I thought this was really good, the definition of the word character is the mental and moral qualities distinctive to an individual. Now, you just think about this with me. Is God an individual? The character is how we define a person. I am known by my character, and you are known by your character. So is God an individual that can be known by his character? And therefore, how can we know his character? And so I submit to you that God is the most important individual character in all the universe. Amen?
Amen.
And the mental and moral quality. The mental is the way the individual thinks. So that's what's on the inside of that person. And the moral qualities, I think, are going to be those mental qualities coming through in their life and their actions to the outside of the person. And so that is why when you read a book, the very first task of any author that's writing a book is to tell you all about the mental and the moral qualities of the people in his story. And we call them the characters, don't we? If you're going to tell a story, you have to tell about the characters. So, your character is what you think and the way that your thoughts cause you to act, right? And so, when we go to the Bible and learn about how God thinks and how he acts, can we truly know and understand the character of God? And my answer is yes. And folks, it is my heart's desire today that we would, everyone, commit ourselves to studying more than ever before our Bibles, but that as we study, that we do so with a mindset that not to prove this or disprove that, but when we study our Bibles, what we should be looking for is the character of God. Every single time we study, we should be looking for the character of God. What do I mean by that? What I mean is this. What does God think about things? When we study our Bibles, it's not important what I think about it and what you think about it. What's the important thing? To know and understand what God thinks about these things that we're studying from his Word. And so, with all this in mind, I want to share some wonderful truths from God's own Word. And I want to start in Acts chapter 17 and verse 11. This is that Bible verse about the Bereans. And it says, "These were more noble than those in Thessalonica in that they received the Word with all readiness of mind and searched the Scriptures daily whether those things were so." The real point to our study last time was to show that the Ten Commandments existed from the very beginning. They did not suddenly come about on Mount Sinai to the Jewish people. They existed from the very beginning. They were there in the Garden of Eden, we saw last week. and that they still exist today, and that they will continue to exist right up to the end of this world's history. Now, some people say that they were nailed to the cross or changed or replaced, and that mentality comes from the fact that many people believe that the Ten Commandments, the Old Testament, was or had to do with the Jews only. But folks, we read where the Bible says that they existed before the Jews even existed as a people, and they certainly are taught about the New Testament and even those last day prophecies in the book of Revelation. So these things are very serious allegations that these other people are making, and folks, we're going to look in our Bibles and see what the Bible has to say about all of this. But we want to be like those Bereans in Acts chapter 17, don't we? We want to receive the Word of God with all readiness of mind. In other words, we want to be receptive, don't we? But you can't believe everything you hear. You can't believe all of the expositors, even of God's Word. We want to then also search the Scriptures daily to see whether those things are so. And so, let us begin our study in Luke chapter 18 and verse 19, where Jesus says, "Why callest thou me good? None is good save one, that is God." The purpose of our lesson today is to focus on the wonderful character of God, and so I'm using this Bible verse to show you something about God's character. We're going to look at His character attributes. And one of His character attributes is He is good. God is good. And as we do this, as we look at these different character attributes, we're also going to be looking at the Ten Commandment law to see some very exciting things about it where this is concerned. You see, God is our King, right? And God has a kingdom. And Jesus tells us so much about the kingdom of God, but the King will be known by His kingdom. And that's why Jesus is forever telling stories. The kingdom of God is likened unto... Did Jesus come here to tell people about the kingdom of God? Or did He really come here to tell them about God? You see what I'm saying? These two are connected together. The King will be known by His kingdom, and folks, His kingdom will be known by its laws. So it's a short jump to say that the King is known by His laws. This Bible verse tells us that God is good. Now, I think Jesus is good too, but He was reminding these Pharisees that they did not accept Him as the Son of God. They come to Him and they say, "Good Master." And what did Jesus say? "Why callest thou me good? There is none good but God." Was Jesus good? Yes, He was, because He was God's own Son, wasn't He? But they didn't acknowledge that, so that's the reason He says these feisty words to them. But this verse tells us that God is good. Surely a chief character trait of God is that He is good. But I also want to show you that God's law is good too. Romans 7:12 says, "Wherefore the law is holy, and the commandment holy and just and good." So the King is known by His kingdom and its laws, the kingdom's laws. We like to say it this way: the Ten Commandments are the transcript of God's holy character. Transcript means to write it down. The Bible says that Jesus is the Word of God in bodily form. It also says the Bible is the Word of God in transcript, or writing down, written form. So the Bible is the transcript of God's Word, the writing down of God's Word. In just the same way, we believe that the Ten Commandments are the writing down of the character of God, the transcript of His holy character. So what do we see from God's own Word? The Bible says God is good, and His commandments are holy, just, and good, right? If God is truly good, can He possibly have a bad law? I mean, that just wouldn't make at all any sense, would it? And so, really, this shows us that what needs to change about the Ten Commandments, it's really our attitude toward them. And I don't think a lot of people have a correct attitude where the laws of God are concerned. In 1 John 3:3 it says, "And every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure." So there's another character trait of God, isn't it? What is God here? He's pure. You remember the old Ivory Soap commercials? 99.44% pure. That seems pretty pure, doesn't it? But do you understand that by the definition of terms, if I say something that is 99.44%, I've already told you it's not pure. Now, that's interesting, isn't it? Pure means pure. 100% pure, by definition. And folks, God is pure. Amen? The glory of this Bible verse, though, is that He is in the business of making every faithful Christian pure, too. Can we be pure? According to the Bible, we sure can. But look at this. Psalms 19, verse 8 says, "The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is what? Pure, enlightening the eyes." Folks, the commandments, the Ten Commandments, are good, just like God is good. And they are pure, just like God is pure. You see what I mean when I say the character traits? The Ten Commandment law of God is the character of God. John 3:33, "He that hath received His testimony hath set to His seal that God is true." Another wonderful character trait of God is that He is true. Well, what about His law? Titus 1:2 says, God is true, and how true is God? I threw another Bible verse in here. Titus 1:2 says, "In hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began." How true is God? He's 100%, isn't He? He's pure. The Bible says that God cannot lie. And folks, I believe exactly what it says there. Got me in trouble a time or two when I said it. But it does not say that He will not lie. It says that He cannot lie. And I believe that that is a true statement, because I also believe that there is creative power in His Word. When God said, "Let there be light," what happened? There was light. It was just that simple. Now, I believe that there was light because He said it. Not because He designed it, not because He built it, but because He said it. God cannot lie. His Word is true, and He is true, and if He says something, there's such creative power that it comes to be. Now look at what the Bible also says in Psalms 119, verse 142. And by the way, if you want to get a good picture of the law and what the Bible has to say about the law, just read Psalms 119. The longest chapter in the Bible is Psalms 119. And you know what it talks about all the way through it? The Ten Commandments. That's right. Psalms 119, verse 142, "Thy righteousness is an everlasting righteousness, and thy law is what?"
Truth.
That's right. God is true. His law is true. Psalms 119, verse 151. Again, it says, "Thou art near, O Lord, and all thy commandments are truth." The Ten Commandments are true, just like God is true, because that's one of his character attributes. Now, probably the most famous of all of God's attributes, 1 John 4:8, "He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love," right? Probably the chief attribute we would say of God's wonderful character is that God is love. Well, what about his law? Romans 13:10 says, "Love worketh no ill to his neighbor, therefore love is the fulfilling of the law." Folks, God is love, and so therefore, his law has to be a law of love. Remember what we talked about last week? When we, through his power, keep his commandments, we prove our love for him. By keeping the first four commandments, we prove our love for him especially, and by keeping the last six commandments, we prove that we love our neighbor as ourselves, don't we? Why did God give us the commandments anyway?
They were the standard to live by.
The standard to live by? That's a good answer. And I suppose we could give a lot of answers, but I want to take you to a Bible verse that I really love. It's Deuteronomy 6:24. It says, "And the Lord commanded us to do all these statutes, to fear the Lord our God, for our good always, that he might preserve us alive as it is at this day." Why did God give us his Ten Commandments?
We wouldn't have a problem, would we? Right.
God gave us the Ten Commandments because he loves us, because he cares for us, because he wants us to have good, for our good always, it says, and that he might preserve us alive. Is there safety found in God's commandments? Yes, there are. Folks, it's because he loves us that he gives us his Ten Commandments. Isn't that the whole motivation behind these laws of love? Why does a parent make rules for their children? Why do they enforce those rules?
For their good.
It's for their good, isn't it? Surely it's because we love our children and we want to protect them from all harm. And folks, that's just exactly what God is telling us here in this Bible verse. Another character attribute is found in Matthew 5:48. "Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which in heaven is perfect." Folks, God is perfect. What do you think he tells us about his law in the Bible? Psalms 19:7 says, "The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple." So again, God is perfect, so his law is perfect. If he's perfect, could he make any other kind of a law? I mean, it just doesn't meet with any kind of sense, does it? But yet we're going to bypass all of this wonderful information, and we're going to come up with a reason why his law has been changed or his law has been done away with. No, that just won't work. James 1:25 says, "But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed." Now think about it. If God's law is perfect, would there ever be any reason or any need to change it? So that kind of does away in and of itself. That does away with the argument that says that God has changed or done away with his law. Leviticus 19:2 says, "Speak unto all the congregation of the children of Israel, and say unto them, you shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy." The Bible says that God is holy. Again, there's several places where it says that God is holy, but I picked this one because there is a promise in this one for us, is there not? What is God's intention for his people, folks? He wants us to be holy just like he is holy. But what else is holy? Romans 7:12. We read it before, but it says the law is holy and the commandment holy and just and good. Folks, God's Ten Commandment law is holy. Now here is a principle that I think is important. If something is made holy by God himself, can we just do whatever we want to do with it? Can we set it aside? Can we change it? Folks, I say and I believe the Bible says it very clearly that if God makes something holy, we cannot make anything holy. We cannot replace it with something else. We don't have that kind of power. We don't have that kind of ability. And there are a lot of other things like this we'll talk about as we go through our studies together. Genesis 21, verse 33. "And Abraham planted a grove in Beersheba and called there on the name of the Lord." Called there on the name of the Lord. And what does it say? The everlasting God. God is everlasting. The Bible says from everlasting to everlasting, doesn't it? No beginning and no end. But did you know that the exact same statement is said of his holy law? Psalms 105 verse 10, "And confirm the same unto Jacob for a law and to Israel for an everlasting covenant." His law was given for an everlasting covenant or agreement or contract. And Psalms 119, 44 says, "So shall I keep thy law continually forever and ever." Folks, the Bible makes it plain that the Ten Commandment law upon which God bases his covenant, the government of his kingdom, it's eternal. And so, really and truly, like God himself, it has no beginning or end. If God has no beginning and no end, and the law is the transcript of his holy character, is it possible that the law has a beginning or an end? No. It's the same as with God himself. Folks, that law is never going to be taken away because it is the transcript of God's holy character. And God's character isn't going to change, is it? Consider these next few verses. Luke 16:17. "And it is easier for heaven and earth to pass than one tittle of the law to fail." It's easier for God's creation to pass away than for one little bit of his law to fail. It just can't happen. Psalms 111, verses 7 and 8. "The works of his hands are verity and judgment. All his commandments are sure. They stand fast forever and ever and are done in truth and uprightness." Folks, God's Ten Commandments are going to stand forever. In 2 Kings 17:37, it says, "The statutes and the ordinances and the law and the commandment which he wrote for you, you shall observe to do forevermore, and you shall not fear other gods." Evermore, it says. And Ecclesiastes 3:14 says, "I know that whatsoever God doeth, it shall be forever. Nothing can be put to it, nor anything taken from it, and God doeth it that men should fear before him." Again, if God is perfect, and he is, then what would be the necessity of a change in his perfect law? Actually, in Malachi 3, verse 6, it says, "I am the Lord, I change not." And that's like a promise for us. Psalms 37 and verse 4 says, "Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart." Now, you might think this is a little bit of a stretch, but I'm putting this verse up before you because I think it says that God is delightful. Can you see it? Is God delightful? The Bible says so in several places, not just this one. But you know what? We read of his law in Psalms 119, verse 47, "And I will delight myself in thy commandments, which I have loved." Are the Ten Commandments delightful? Now, I know that's a stretch for some people. But when our minds are right, God's law is delightful. We're supposed to delight ourselves in his law. We're supposed to delight ourselves in his Sabbath. We're supposed to delight ourselves in he himself, in God's presence in our lives. 1 John 5:3 says, "For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous." There's people that keep the Ten Commandment law and they hate every minute of it. And that's not the way it's supposed to be. When our minds are right, God's commandments are not a terrible burden for us. They never were meant to be, but they are meant to be a delight. Because what do? They protect us. They keep us safe. They keep us happy, according to the verse that we read. They keep us happy, healthy, and alive, as it is this day. It's what we just read a few minutes ago. All right, 1 Corinthians 1:9, another character trait. God is what? He's faithful. The Bible says that he is a God of faith and that without faith it is impossible to please him. So is he faithful? Yes, he sure is. What about the law? Psalms 119, verse 86. All thy commandments are what? Faithful. The commandments are faithful too. And when we're on the wrong side, they may seem to persecute us and they may seem wrong. But that's because we're on the wrong side. If we're in our right minds, if we're thinking right, his law is delightful. They're not burdensome. God's commandments are faithful just like he is faithful. Jeremiah 23 and verse 6, another one. "In his days Judah shall be saved and Israel shall dwell safely, and this is his name, whereby he shall be called the Lord our righteousness." Wow, look at all those capital letters. Do you think the Bible is trying to tell us something here? God is righteous. Amen? In fact, this is represented to us here as one of his names, as a proper name of God, the Lord our righteousness. What about the transcript of his character? Deuteronomy 4:8 says, "And what nation is there so great that hath statutes and judgments so righteous as all this law which I set before you this day. What are the commandments? They are righteous, just like the God they represent. Again, Psalms 119, verse 172. My tongue shall speak of thy words, for all thy commandments are righteousness. Folks, the Ten Commandments are righteousness because they are the transcript of His holy character, and He is the Lord, our righteousness. 1 John 1:5. This is then the message we have heard of Him and declare unto you, that God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all. Now, what does the Bible say in this verse? What would be the character attribute? Sounds a little different. It says God is light. Now, you know that we are supposed to be the light of the world, aren't we? And you also know, where do we get the light from? Well, Jesus is the light of the world. And so we get the light from Jesus. But where did the light come from? I mean, it's apparent, isn't it? And so, who really is the light of the world? The Father is. Actually, He's the light of the universe, isn't He? He's the light of everything that exists. The Bible says that God is light. And so you know what it's going to say about the law, the transcript of His character? Believe it or not, Proverbs 6:23, for the commandment is a lamp, and the law is what? Light. And reproofs of instruction are the way of life. Once again, the commandment is just exactly like the commander. Amen? Job 37, verse 14. Hearken unto this, O Job. Stand still and consider the wondrous works of God. So on my list of the character attributes of God, I'm telling you, He's wondrous. And He's filled with wondrous works. And the Bible says here to consider the wondrous works of God. But it also says in 1 Chronicles 16:9, sing unto Him, sing psalms unto Him, talk ye of all His wondrous works. Folks, there are no less than 15 times in the Bible that it tells us to consider and to talk about His wondrous works in the world. So folks, God is wondrous. His works are wondrous. What does it say in Psalms 119 about this? Verse 18, open thou mine eyes that I may behold what? Wondrous things out of thy law. So what else is wondrous? The law of God is wondrous. Am I making my point? So far, I've showed you 12 attributes of God's holy character that are also used to describe His holy law. And I think that is sufficient. We've made the point. I promise you, we could go on and on and on with this Bible study. But I think we have made the point. When you look at the Ten Commandment law of God, you are looking at the character of God. So as we close, I just want to share one more of these with you. 2 Chronicles 6:18 says, but will God in very deed dwell with men on the earth? Behold, heaven and the heaven of heavens cannot contain thee. How much less this house which I have built? Think about this. The Bible says that God is big. Amen? That's what it's saying here. This is the dedication of the temple. And after they built that wonderful, glorious temple for God to come and dwell in their midst, you know, we have to realize that it's all in miniature, so to speak. Because there's no way we could build a house. This church certainly could not contain all that is God. But I also think about that song. Have you ever heard that song, How Big Is God? It's a beautiful, beautiful song. But in that song, it says, How big is God? And at the end of it, at the chorus, it says, He's big enough to rule this mighty universe, but small enough to live within my heart. So God has a way of doing what He needs to do for us and with us. But do you remember what John said about Jesus and all of His works? Remember at the end of the book of John, he said, if all the works of Jesus were to be written down in books, what did he say? Not even the world would be able to contain all of those books. We call Him omnipotent. That means all powerful. And we call Him omniscient. That means all knowing. And we call Him omnipresent. Means He's everywhere at one time, right? He's everywhere present. But folks, look at Psalms 119, verse 96. I have seen an end of all perfection, but thy commandment is exceeding broad. I want to tell you, God is big and His law is big. And they still go together. What I really want to say to you is this. God's Ten Commandment law is limitless. Don't you believe God is limitless? So if it's a transcript of His character, I would submit to you that like He is limitless, the Ten Commandments are limitless. And I want you to think about this. There's only Ten Commandments. But we believe they cover everything that you can encounter in this world, don't we? Don't you think that's got to be a miracle? Isn't that an amazing miracle? How could 10 sentences, so to speak, I know there's a few more thrown in there, but how could 10 sentences cover everything? You just think about the United States government and how many laws they have. I heard one time that when in session, Congress makes over 200 laws a day when they're in session. They average over 200 laws a day. And we're almost living in chaos when it comes to those laws. But yet God takes apparently 10 commandments and they cover it all. They cover all the government of His kingdom. I want to leave you with one last Bible verse. 1 Thessalonians 5:21 says, prove all things. Hold fast that which is good. And folks, God is perfect and unchangeable. And I think I've shown you today beyond any shadow of a doubt that the Ten Commandment law of God is perfect and unchangeable too. The Ten Commandments truly are the transcript or writing down of His holy character. And folks, how unthinkable is it that His professed people would be so careless with the keeping of His holy law, His holy character? How ridiculous it is to think that we can get together and decide to set something aside that He has made holy, or to change something that He has made holy. But we've already said most of the Christian world has done this. And so, when we get together the next time, we're going to talk about some of the problems with this decision. And I just want to leave you with this verse. Prove all things. Hold fast that which is good. I don't care how many times you've heard their silly cliches. I'm showing you the Word of God. And we need to prove all these things. We need to study to show ourselves approved. We need to search the Scriptures daily to see if those things are so. And we need to prove all things and hold fast that which is good. Next week, we're going to consider the two laws, and that study is going to answer a lot of the questions about the confusion and the deception concerning God's Ten Commandment law.